Anyway, this is all about taxa, taxonomic concepts. Now, the reason this is separated from identification terms is that Darwin Core can be used to create records just about taxa. So this could be nomenclatural lists, this could be checklists. So in Darwin Core, you could make a list of taxa for a country using just taxa, taxon fields, plus maybe a country field communication. In other words, you can construct data sets from combinations of these terms and have it still be Darwin Core compliant, that is to say, people will understand it because they can work on the bar and read the definitions. But the data set might be some subset of Darwin Core. In this case, it might just be a checklist as opposed to a whole specimen record. We'll see how those distinct uses of Darwin Core can come into play during the publication process when we talk about the integrated publishing toolkit, because it will allow the publication of current records or taxon records to be taxed. They're not mutually exclusive, they just have different purposes. So, I said then that I'd skip identification first to talk about taxon, because identification is the application of a taxon to a specimen or observation. And this is where the information about who said that a specimen belonged to a given taxon is captured. So who identified it, when it was identified, what references were used, how it was verified, and the extent to which it was verified, any kind of remarks and qualifiers, and whether or not it's a type specimen, all fall into the category of identification. I told you about these other auxiliary terms. I told you also that these are not used in single Darwin Core. If we have time or if we have the necessity when it comes to office hours to try to capture more information in your data sets than is possible in single Darwin Core, then we'll talk about these things. But otherwise, I'm going to ignore them for the rest of the workshop, because we'll stay within the confines of single Darwin Core. So, to this point, what I hope to have shown you is how the actual Darwin Core standard website is a tool of reference to understand all the Darwin Core terms. It's all here. All the definitions, the entire list is all here. Now, there is further information about these terms that's available, and I'd like to show you how you find. So let's go to, let's say, continent, country code. Doesn't really matter which one. Let's say country code. This is a term. Country code belongs in the location class. It's about location. Definition says it's the standard code for the country, which the location codes. It's a recommended best practice to use the ISO standard called 3166-1 alpha 2. You will have seen this as country code that uses two letters. I believe the country code for Kenya is KE. Is that correct? And you would notice that if you looked at the end of URLs that initiate in this country. So that's one place in which a country code is used. Okay. So here are a couple of examples. AR, the country code for Argentina, SD for El Salvador, and so on. The important thing I want to point out here is that every term, you can see here, for discussion, there's a link to a page on the Darwin Core Google code site. That's where the active commentary and so on for Darwin Core occurs. So every one of these terms allows you to link to the page where there might be a discussion about that term. So here I've clicked on the link, and I've opened a page whose title is location. So this is all the information, the extra information about terms in the location class of the report. There are geographic terms, related and coordinate terms, and georeference terms, subclasses of location. And in here, what I'm looking for is country code. There's an entry for country code, which means that somewhere there was a discussion or additional information that wasn't written in the standard itself about country code and its use. So here it is. And what has somebody added? I said, well, okay, the recommended official list of terms the country code can be found in the same location. That's pretty helpful. That wasn't in the standard itself, but it's contained in this auxiliary information. Okay. So to show you that there is more than one level of information about the standard, the reason why they're divided like this is that the standard has a governance to it. There are rules about how and when the standard can change, and that process requires a great deal of deliberation and actual decisions to be made by people. That is not very flexible. What it does is it serves to keep the core, the standard itself, stable over time. There's resistance to change built into it. In other words, change only comes if it's been determined by the community as a whole, with consensus, that something needs to change. In the meantime, if it's not so important, or if it's something that can vary, then the standard doesn't have to really say anything about it, doesn't have to commit, and therefore doesn't have to change all the time. And the problem with change is that if it's a standard and it gets changed, then you really don't have a basis for persistence, let's say. You don't know what's the most up-to-date thing. You'd like to have a standard be stable. And yet, we want it to be flexible. And so we have a second level of information about the standard, which says, okay, the Dharma Corps recommends the use of this code, but it does not require it. Very important distinction. Dharma Corps actually has no requirements. It doesn't say you must use a date, time, field for event date. It says you should, because it will help people. It doesn't require it. Here, the requirement is still not a requirement, it's a suggestion, and it's giving further information about its use. So why does Dharma Corps state that? The reason is that in our experience, placing those constraints at the level of the standard terms almost makes sure that the standard is unusable. Why is that? Let me give you one concrete example. One of the problems we have in the biodiversity domain is that we have a lot of primary data coming out of collections databases, and those data are not clean. Well, if they're not clean and we have constraints on the fields in Dharma Corps, it means they couldn't actually even be published unless they fit the constraints. Well, that's great if the purpose for Dharma Corps entirely is to have only clean data in the world, and that perfect data, if there were such a thing, is the only thing that's acceptable share. Well, if we went with that assumption, we would have no shared data, and it would be pretty pointless to have a standard. This is by experience. So, the reason for not implementing the constraints at the standard level itself is so that we can share dirt and data. Why? Because, as a group and in collaboration, it's quite useful to see the dirty data. Quite useful to provide services to help clean up those dirty data or flag them. So imagine that you're a curator. you really want to get your data out there, you want your museum to be visible, and yet you don't have the resources to make sure that all the data fit this dotted core, and it's all perfectly clean. The real world has researchers out there who are intensely interested in the data in whatever form they are. That's why they write you email messages asking for it. That's why you make Excel spreadsheets to send back to them. Well, why not allow them to get those data by searching anyway, even if they're doing it? And then, if they happen to provide further effort looking at those data, for example, georeferencing them, give those data back to you to incorporate into your own collections. Or what if the world created a nice service that took taxonomic names and resolved them to a current taxonomic classification system? In other words, you could publish your names that are out of date with 19th century taxonomy and have a service help you to identify what the taxonomy and classification should be today, without having to have the data in advance. In other words, don't let the standard be an obstacle to what the world can provide to those who are publishing the data. Let the data be published, let people see it, let services see it, let the data be improved, commented upon, annotated, and used. That's the philosophy behind which Darwin 4 does not put in all those constraints. Now, it is making suggestions that if you want your data to be more easily searchable, here are the rules we'd like you to follow. And during the course of this workshop, we're going to try to take data from its original form and do our best to put it into the Darwin 4 to try to follow these rules, to find out what problems occur, and to try to not lose any information along the way by putting things in the right place. Does that all make sense? Giving you everything from the philosophy of the standard to its detailed implementation and references, both standard and sort of community-driven and dynamic following that standard. Okay. I'm not sure how I'm doing time. So I have gone as far as some of the details. I have until 1 to a whole bunch more. I think, given the time, the exercise that I wanted to do is going to have to be a homework exercise. Yeah, question.
This tool are very impressive, but